you have any issue, you just go and dump all your bad feelings out there. It's like your garbage place, you know. Take out all your frustration and all your this thing. But it's not a bad way to look at it. The reason why many of us, our relationships suffer, our productivity suffers, is because we are carrying all these frustrations, angry feelings or sad feelings. We're carrying it around there and we're spilling it out in the wrong places. When you have a counseling session or a psychotherapy session, it's a place where you're officially going there to dump your garbage, psychological garbage. It's a good way of looking at it. So that once it's out there, you rejected it from your system, you're not carrying that with you, and you're not disturbing other normal life activities and relationships. And I think I want to again re-emphasize the idea that I'm saying your family and friends are very well-meaning, but always keep in mind they're not trained to help you to deal with your issues. And sometimes they themselves are issues. Even if they are well-meaning, you may have issues with your family or you may have issues with people who you are very close to. Definitely, they're not going to sit and sort it out with you. Okay, I'm not going to answer that. Sorry?
Non-pathological mental changes considered. Non-pathological.
Right.
Pathological changes is
That's right. Anybody else has any thoughts or anything?
What happens is more than the counselor says that convincing.
Academic is very simple.
Yeah. Pathological changes.
Okay, let me see what else I. It's also very important to be aware of mental health services in your city, wherever you live. Firstly, you have to decide whether you need help or not. If it's not only you, but if you are aware, then you can decide if anybody in your family, in your community, if you see people with very bizarre behavior, or if you see that they are not able to look after themselves, or if you see somebody who's a very difficult person where nobody ever wants to be around him. It can be at your workplace or in your neighborhood. Then you know definitely that this person needs some help. So you need to be aware of mental health services in your city. We have a directory of mental health services, of psychiatrists, psychologists, counselors in the city. And you can also call up helplines and find them out. So that's very important. Yeah? That's what exactly I was sharing earlier. Even we face that, and if you are a caretaker also you face a problem in taking the person to see care. Yeah.
So
you're talking about taking an adult or a child?
Child is easier. Child probably could listen to you.
I think you have to build some ground with the person that you want, you know, to take to a mental health professional. Because it's like you have to sell him this idea of mental health. That firstly, it's not for somebody who's just totally crazy. And you have to show your own well-meaningness. You may be well-meaning, you have to put it in words and say it. You know, that I've seen that, you know, so much time has gone by and, you know, whatever, I don't know. Whatever you see, you first have to be very objective and describe what you see. And how does it make you feel when you see what you see? It's like suppose a person who has almost become an invalid, a very productive person has become invalid, and you see that person is always hanging at home, doing nothing almost. Then you have to tell them that, you know, it's been so long or this much time has passed. You describe the time frame. Tell that I see that, you know, you're just sitting there and, you know, I've seen that in better days, you know, you were doing this. I feel very concerned. I feel I really would, you know, like to see you getting back to your old days. And, you know, would you like to come? It's always an invitation and it's always persuasion that works. Because I think mostly what happens is the reason people also, we live, there's a whole facade of normalcy. Facade of normalcy. Anybody has heard this term? Facade of normalcy. There's also a movie made called Everybody Says I'm Fine. Anybody has seen that? Yeah, heard that?
Heard what?
Heard it, yeah. Everybody says I'm fine. If normal greetings, if anybody asks, how are you? You'll say, I'm fine, thank you, how are you? Right? Because that's normality, that's cordiality. But beyond the cordiality, each of us are dealing with our own issues. So when we talk about facade of normalcy, of course at one level we have to live in a society and to show, we all have, the whole word personality comes from a word called persona. It's a mask. Persona means mask. So we all, it's almost like the whole society is wearing a mask. The moment you leave your home, you wear a mask and you're leaving your home. Do you get what I'm saying? So you, at once, you're becoming something. Of course you are what you are, but to show the world you are a different, you're wearing a mask. Only you know what is inside you. It's like everybody's on a, out on a masquerade ball, you know. Everybody. And you're wearing a mask, and it's almost like you're wearing a uniform which contains all the externals about you in terms of your job and your situation, you know, whatever your post that you're holding, all the things which externally make you the person that you are. And that's what everybody sees. But inside, if you're having any difficulties and if you're not feeling as good and as healthy and as capable, that's a part of you, the child part of your personality, which you'll hold to yourself. And may or may not reveal it. Maybe with friends, with family, that part will come out. But sometimes with friends and family also, in such a busy life today, who has the time? You take your sob stories to your friends, and I can guarantee you, you will have lesser friends. I've seen that from my own personal experiences. If you are routinely talking about your problems to your friends, friends will avoid you. Because everybody would like to be an agni aunt for a little time or sometimes, not all the time. And family also the same thing. So you're carrying a very vulnerable part of yourself which is not being dealt with or which is not being exposed. So I think a good place to explore that is a counseling or a psychotherapy session. And it is difficult to take people or refer people. You just have to keep on believing in the whole idea of mental health. Anybody has any questions? Any more questions? Sorry? We still have time. I have finished sharing all the information. I'm just looking up what else can I tell you. Okay, I was telling you about this continuum that when I was talking to you about mental health continuum, from moving from normality, neurotic, psychoneurotic and psychotic.
And was it feeling like Ayurveda or something like that, help or medication?
When I was talking about the mental health continuum and when we are moving away from the reality principle, what we do is we use defense mechanisms. Just as physically, to protect ourselves, we use defenses. Okay, you learn some martial arts, or to protect your body every day you wear different types of clothes, or you wear a cap to protect yourself from sun. Psychologically also, as I said, the mind is a very complex place. So you develop these things which are called defense mechanisms. These are psychological unconscious ways that you develop to deal with the reality that you have to deal with. Because as I said, sometimes reality is too harsh to deal with. And you use different ways to cope with it. One of the ways is defense mechanisms. And my homework to you is to read upon defense mechanisms. It's like a whole, it's a very interesting topic. And I think this was one of my favorite topics when we were studying in our bachelor days. So defense mechanisms is something that I wanted to tell you about. Sorry, what are you saying? if you have any questions related to what happens, I think I already told you to some extent what happens in a counseling session. If you have any questions related to what is counseling and what really happens in counseling. Coming to your question on whether alternate sources or healing, there are many alternate therapies which are being practiced today. Like you were talking about pranic healing, right? I think the bottom line, whatever you're facing, you want to deal with that. Whatever helps you is good. What doesn't help you is not good. Whatever distress that you're facing, it should be alleviated. It does not matter who do you go to and whether you're standing upside down on your head, whether you're going to a counselor, whether you're going to somebody who's doing chakra healing, pranic healing. I am not aware of each of these different alternate therapies. So I'm saying bottom line is that it should connect. Every person is a different person. Somebody believes in yoga. Somebody believes in going for Gita lectures. Somebody thinks that I think I have the information. I want to go on the Google and read it up on my own. Somebody wants to go to a counselor because they want to go to a trained professional. Somebody wants to talk to a friend. Whatever helps you and takes away all that, the distress that you're facing, that is what is good. That's the best way to. If you find that one thing is not helping, you have to stop there and try something else. And when we're talking about mental health, I think I have given you some understanding of it. I think a trained professional is the best person to deal with it. All the alternate therapies, to my knowledge, are add-ons. They are add-ons for a person who's of sound mental health. These are add-ons, right? What a mental health professional is trying to do is make you a normal person, which means like an optometrist is giving you the right number, saying that wear these glasses and you will see the world the way it is. Because you are wearing either incorrect glasses or you are not having glasses. So you're seeing a distorted world. I think this glasses is a good example to keep in mind to understand mental health issues. So a mental health professional, counselor, psychotherapist, psychiatrist is doing that to you. Now add-ons, how you beautify your life and everything else, getting into idealism, that you can put everything, whatever you want. A psychotherapist. See, there are in psychology there are different schools of thought. Because it's such a vast field, we are talking about emotions, thinking, and behavior. There are different type of psychologists who believe in different things. There are some who are called cognitive. Cognitive believe only mostly in the thoughts, the power of thoughts. They believe your thoughts influence everything else. They influence your behavior. So if you have irrational thoughts, they deal with your thoughts. They're called cognitive psychologists. Then you have behavioral people who believe that your behavior, whatever behavior that you show, that needs to be changed. Because incorrect behavior leads to punishment and the right behavior leads to rewards. It's like that. So by, you know, changing your behavior, they want to change you as a person. Yeah? And then there are emotional. There are gestalt psychologists who have a gestalt approach, only emotions. Everything is about emotions. There are some who are holistic, they combine all three. So different psychotherapies is whoever believes in what, they have a training in that. And psychotherapy is basically, you have to give some time to it. Because you are going through a process of personal change. And you are going to the root of the problem. Whereas in counseling, you are surface handling of the problem. This is my problem and you know, what can I do about it? It's more a brainstorming of what can you do about it. The counselor is not like a coach, is not taking you through the process. Counselor could also do that. Everything depends on the meeting between the counselor and the client. How much time and money both have. How much time and money the client has and how much time the counselor has. And in choosing a counselor, I was telling you to be aware of what you're in the city, what are the services available. Then other things is like very important. Today everybody, many of the counselors I see, they're doing part-time short courses and everybody's become a counselor. And because there are so many alternate therapies also which have come in, Some of them are also dealing with the mind. So when I'm talking about mental health, I'm saying a person should have a basic master's degree in counseling or clinical psychology with add-ons maybe of other courses and some years of experience. Because if you're very fresh off the board, you're working a lot from theory. But a few years and you get some experience of meeting different people.
You can't predict this and all that.